Welcome to our service for Remembrance Sunday, brought to you from our parishes of Bucklebury, Bradfield and Stanford Dingley. Hear these words of Scripture. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with the Lord your God? We meet in the presence of God. We commit ourselves to work in penitence and faith for reconciliation between the nations, that all people may together live in freedom, justice, and peace. We pray for all who, in bereavement, disability and pain, continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and terror. We remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts, past and present, have been given and taken away. Our first hymn, O God, our help in ages past.
Thank you. Let us remember before God those who have died for their country in war, those whom we know and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of mankind, especially William Herbert Watney, William Clark, Bertie Stuart Cox, Sidney Hawkins, Edward John Naylor, Arthur Wheatcroft, Edward Herbert Brooks, William Charles West.
To the glory of God, and in the proud memory of the 38 men of Bucklebury who fell in the Great War 1914 to 1918. Alfred Arnold, Arthur Bailey, Jack Burt, Ernest Burt, Jack Butcher, Ernest Barlow, William Carter, Frederick Carter, Tom Collins, Oliver Chamberlain, George Cox, William Cox, Arthur Cripps, Walter Fawcett, James Green, Raymond Green, Horace Gower, Ebor Hazel, Malcolm Carr, George Lay, John Marshall, Alfred Marshall, James Marshall, William Matthews, Archer Morton, John Morgan, Maurice Naylor, David Pierce, Sidney Pusey, Frederick Sharp, Robert Stevenson, Stanley Tull, Arthur Tull, Frederick Vallis, William Wallin, Albert Wigmore, Walter Wigmore, and Tom Woodidge. To the glory of God, and in the proud memory of the 12 men of Bucklebury who fell in the Second World War, 1939 to 1945. Eric Andrews, Jack Bidmead, Leonard Gunter, Charles Hull, Gerald Kennedy, John Lawrence, Reginald Mallard, Robert Neat, Hector Newman, William Savory, Frederick Webb, and Timothy Wildblood.
Edwin Wild, G. Prescott Blackall Simmons, G. P. M. Scudamore, Henry Strange, Leonard Strange, Edgar Lewis, Frank Poole, William Phillips, Albert Titchener, Wilfred Wilson. Harold Brooks, Edwin Hall, Charles Henderson Harwood, Frank Tigwell, Percy Rumble, Charles Hillier, Stephen Wickens, Ernest Braybrook, Edward Bushell, Rupert Cox. William Cox, Ernest Green, Archie Hurst, Albert Little, William Milson, Alfred Small, Harold Williams, Stanley Patey, William Small, William Stevens, William Watney. Leonard Cox, Val Rowe, Reuben Weston, George Cripps, Charles Hunt, C.J. Knapp, Frederick Nicholas, John Nicholas, Robert Kerwood, George Mooney, Ernest Bendel. Edward Johnson, P.J.C. Radford Norcop, M.L.K. Losley, A.R. Hannington, S.A. Willoughby.
They shall grow not old, as we who are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
Thank you.
Ever-living God, we remember those whom you have gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May that same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all peoples, and establish harmony among the nations. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess to God the sins and shortcomings of the world, its pride, its selfishness, its greed, its evil divisions and hatreds. Let us confess our share in what is wrong and our failure to seek and establish that peace which God wills for his children. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We come now to our readings, after which Lynn will be preaching.
The Old Testament reading today is from Deuteronomy 17, 14 to 20, under the title, The King. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, and have taken possession of it and settled in it, and you say, let us set a king over us like all the nations around us. Be sure to appoint over you a king the Lord your God chooses. He must be from among your fellow Israelites. Do not place a foreigner over you, one who is not an Israelite. The king, moreover, must not acquire great numbers of horses for himself or make the people return to Egypt to get more of them. For the Lord has told you, you are not to go back that way again. He must not take many wives, or his heart will be led astray. He must not accumulate large amounts of silver and gold. When he takes the throne of his kingdom, he is to write for himself on a scroll a copy of this law, taken from that of the Levitical priests. It is to be with him, and he is to read it all the days of his life, so that he may learn to revere the Lord his God and follow carefully all the words of this law and these decrees, and not consider himself better than his fellow Israelites, and turn from the law to the right or to the left. Then he and his descendants will reign a long time over his kingdom in Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Saviour, who wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all men, the testimony given in its proper time. And for this purpose, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I'm not lying, and a teacher of the true faith to the Gentiles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
On May the 24th this year, it was the 80th anniversary of King George VI calling the nation to pray. The British expeditionary force of about 375,000 soldiers was trapped at Dunkirk. One of the greatest disasters in UK military history seemed to be in the making, with the British Army facing annihilation. There was only one place where the naval boats could come in and rescue soldiers due to the shallow sea. Churchill's advisers estimated that only 30,000, that's less than 10%, of those soldiers would get out alive. It was a pivotal moment in history, and then something happened that has only happened in our nation just a handful of times. King George VI, on a radio address to the nation, called a day of prayer. 1 million people queued up outside churches to pray to the God who answers. Millions of people at home called out for their loved ones, pleading with God to rescue them. What happened next was miraculous. 850 small boats, those that we've come to know as the little ships, set out from the south coast to attempt the rescue. They found that the waters of the English Channel were mercifully calm, and a sudden fog provided cover. Strategic mistakes were made by the enemy. Freak localised storms appeared out of nowhere and grounded attack aircraft. Many people had personal stories of protection. Over 330,000, that's nearly 90% of those soldiers, were evacuated from the beaches and brought home to our shores. Now, there was undoubtedly much courage and self-sacrifice shown that day. But I think that the miracle of Dunkirk came because this nation humbled itself, got on its knees, and called out to the Lord. The Lord listened. He answered their prayers. In our reading today from 1 Timothy, it begins with an exhortation to pray. To pray for all people, including those who govern the countries of the world in which we live. When we look at world politics and consider those in power and those striving for power, it can seem like a futile task. Our opinion might be that they are perhaps godless people who would certainly not be willing to be led by God. And we might wonder if it's worth praying at all. When the words in Timothy's letter were written, the people were under the leadership of Nero. Nero was the Roman emperor who hated Christianity so much that he set Christians alight to use as flaming torches at his barbecues. Imagine how it must have been to be asked to pray for him. How much easier it is for us to pray for our leaders. We're not meant just to sit back and accept whatever may come. We ought to fight in prayer for our leaders and for our world, regardless of what type of person the leader may be. We read in the book of Proverbs, "The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes." God can and will respond to prayer in the way which he, seeing the big picture of eternity, knows to be best. So why should we pray? What's the purpose of our prayers? We were told in the passage that it is so that we can live quiet and peaceful lives. Those of you familiar with the Book of Common Prayer Communion Service may remember that the Queen is prayed for. We ask that God rules the Queen Elizabeth's heart and that she, knowing whose minister she is, may above all things seek God's honour and glory. This is to fulfil the purpose that we are godly and quietly governed, and that justice is administered, wickedness and vice punished, and the true gospel maintained. This makes it clear that the Queen is under God's authority to do what is needed for the flourishing of society. It's an onerous task and one which needs and deserves to be supported in prayer. We are to pray for those in authority so that God can act on our behalf. If we don't stand up for something in an ungodly world, you know, if we don't take up the fight in this way for what is right, who will? All those who prayed at the invitation of King George VI were a real testimony to the power of prayer. They showed what prayer can accomplish in terms of giving us the liberty and freedom to live our lives as we are able to do today. We are all under the authority of God, and further on in the passage, in verses 5 and 6, we are reminded of the way which Jesus bought our freedom through his death on a cross. He paid the ransom for us. Ransom is about buying freedom. Freedom of choice is God's gift to us. That gift was abused in the Garden of Eden, and we continue to abuse it today. But it's a precious gift, and Jesus paid for it with his life. We are able to choose whether to follow his ways and choose to accept his lordship in our lives. It is right, therefore, that we pray for our leaders to facilitate our freedom. Now, many countries do not have that freedom. Christians are persecuted. Worship is prohibited. If Jesus gave his life for our freedom, then we must pray that those in leadership allow it. Prayer changes the world, and it's something that we can do wherever we are, even in lockdown. I love what Open Doors founder Brother Andrew says. Our prayers can go where we cannot. There are no borders, no prison walls, no doors that are closed to us when we pray. This is particularly appropriate for us at this time. Many of us are largely confined to our homes through lockdown, and some have more time at their disposal. Since our prayers have no constraint, maybe we could all consider devoting more time to prayer. On the 1st of November, the Archbishops of Canterbury, York and London wrote to all clergy. They said, "Bearing in mind our primary vocation as the Church of Jesus Christ is to pray and to serve, we call upon the Church of England to make this month of lockdown a month of prayer. More than anything else, whatever the nation thinks, we know that we are in the faithful hands of the risen Christ, who knows our weaknesses, tiredness, and struggles, and whose steadfast love endures forever." They went on to say, "During the first lockdown, we cheered for the NHS every Thursday. During this second lockdown, we invite you to fast in a way appropriate to you, as well as to pray for our nation every Thursday, for its leaders, its health and essential services, and all those who suffer. Let's take up that challenge given out by our church leaders. Let's keep praying for those in authority and for those who need to submit to both human authority and God's authority. Just as all those names we read out this morning lived in obedience to their superiors for our good, let us submit to God in our lives so that all may live in peace and safety. Amen.
As we pray today, I invite you to use your poppy, either by detaching it or holding it where it is. If you don't have a poppy with you, please picture one in your mind. First, we hold one of the petals of the poppy. Father, the red of this petal is like the red of the blood shed by so many in wars. We remember members of our family who were directly involved in wars, some in the armed forces, some left behind. We remember injury, trauma, death, courage, fear, lives changed forever. We give thanks for so many who were prepared to pay the highest price of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now, take hold of another petal of your poppy. In doing so, we hold before God the violence and warfare of our own times, the simmering violence, the open hostilities, the threat of terrorism everywhere. We pray, Father, that you will give us politicians and military leaders equal to the huge tasks they face, wise in judgment, calm in spirit, makers of peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now we touch the centre of the poppy, the place where the seeds are kept ready for new life. Lord, take the seeds of peace which lie in the hearts of your people everywhere and cast them generously over every continent and nation. Let seeds germinate, grow and flourish. Beat our swords into ploughshares, our spears into pruning hooks, our weapons of mass destruction into technologies for peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now we hold the green leaf or the green stem and remember the green and growing hope which comes from faith alone. Faith in a God for whom everything is possible, even in the darkest hour. May hope guide our politics, our nations, our thinking, our lives. May hope draw us ever nearer to that day when the world shall be filled with the glory of God as the waters cover the sea. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Gathering our prayers and praises into one, we pray the words that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn, All My Hope on God is Founded. Let us pledge ourselves anew to the service of God and our fellow men and women, that we may help, encourage and comfort one another, and support those working for the relief of the needy and for the peace and welfare of the nations. Lord God our Father, we pledge ourselves to serve you and all humankind in the cause of peace, for the relief of want and suffering, and for the praise of your name. Guide us by your Spirit. give us wisdom, give us courage, give us hope, and keep us faithful now and always. Amen. As we come to the end of our service, a final blessing. God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the Church, the Queen, the Commonwealth and all peoples, unity, peace and concord. And to us and all God's servants, life everlasting through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen.